So it's pi is less than 3. I didn't think that was when it could be on the pi.
Yeah, so, okay, so basically ETA is kind of messed up. And made a problem that was not all that reasonable given what he, given the statement that he gave in class. So we posted an announcement about Piazza making a slightly easier version of the problem that you can solve instead, as well as giving you the statement, which was just a very slight variant of the one he gave in class that you used to solve the full one. Except I just realized now there's another sort of silly thing we did for that problem. Same problem, and so after class we're going to post another way to make the problem easier that you can use. In particular, this is one involving n jobs and n processors. We're going to let you use like 10 n processors or something.
That's fine. It's not going to change the spirit of the problem anyway, so feel free to ask lots of questions on Piazza or come see someone after class if you have further questions about it.
Oh, you're talking about after class. Today is Tuesday, but according to MIT, it's Monday. That in particular means that office hours will be Ali, not me, because I have class on Mondays.
Okay. All right. So last time we covered was we covered consistent hashing and random trees. So I guess first, I hope, you know, I'm glad at least this fraction of the class survived the cold. So I don't know if it's the P-sets or the cold that got people, but hopefully everyone stayed warm. Last time we talked about consistent hashing and random trees. So consistent hashing, you can think about this as what we really covered was we covered hash functions that evolve well. So can anyone tell me what I mean by this, just as a quick reminder for last time? So what is consistent hashing, and what do I mean by evolve well?
So by evolve well, you mean that if you add new servers, you don't have to move that much stuff.
Exactly. So there's some lower bound that if you really want a good hash function, when you add new servers, you do have to move some things, because the new servers have to get at least some jobs. But the point is that the consistent hashing schemes, which we talked about, there are actually many consistent hashing scheme, but that was a particularly simple example. That's something which, as you add new servers, actually the only things that need to move are things that go on the new servers, and yet we analyze some basic properties about consistent hashing schemes we developed that they still maintain pretty uniform loads. So that topic goes a lot further, but it gets a little bit messier. And then we talked about how to actually apply them to get random, to use them in the context of random trees, which was really, you know, routing schemes that work with inconsistent views. This was actually the original application of consistent hashing, was despite the fact that everyone has a different view of which servers are live, how can you still agree upon some protocol that, in spite of these inconsistent views, allows you to defray the load across this one server that, you know, in this one route, which has the file that everyone wants, and actually spread it to many other machines without too many machines being too responsible and getting bombarded with requests. So today, we're going to be talking about something slightly different. We're going to be talking about distinct elements and a sketch called CountMin. So there are links to all of these things up on the course webpage, but really it's going to be two different problems that we study today, the first of which is distinct elements. I'll introduce that. And let me introduce the problem, and then actually let me introduce the sort of meta question, which is going to be underneath all of these. So this is the question that you want to keep in mind throughout. All of these problems are different facets of this question. So the meta question we'll be interested in is, what can we do if we can't store our data? So what do I mean by this? Instead, we're going to think about it as streaming by. So here you're faced with trying to compute some statistics or some other interesting information about data that's just too big to actually keep around. So you think about, for example, all of the query logs being sent through Google. You don't want to store every single one of these, but instead you might want to compute some elementary statistics about this, understanding how many different types of queries there are, or things like what are the most frequent queries. So that'll be the focus today, is really this type of meta question. And the first way that we're going to focus on it is we're going to focus on it on what's called the distinct elements question. So does this make sense as the guiding goal for today? Any questions about this? So the way to think about this is hash functions gave us interesting ways to do lots of things. But hash functions, at the very least, they need to be able to store the data, because then we want to query and retrieve it and do other types of things with it. But what if we want to compute some more blunt statistics of it? We can actually get away with not storing the data. And that's one of the main punchlines. We're going to see a few different ways this comes up. So really, the focus of the first part of the lecture, distinct elements, is, let me phrase it mathematically, and then I'll tell you some of the ways that it comes up. So what we want to do is we want to count the number of, well, what else? Distinct elements in some sequence that's streaming by x1, x2, x3, and it just keeps going on. So you're going to see, for example, some repeated values in here. You know, maybe this value is the same as many other values in here. So the question is, you just want to know how many distinct values are actually showing up in the stream. So what's a naive way to try and do this? Just store it, right? All you do is you just have some sort of hash function that keeps track of which different values you've seen. And then when you try and insert a value that's already been seen, it's not going to do anything. So you'll know that you already have it. And then at the very end of the stream, you're just going to figure out how many distinct values your hash function has stored. So that has the benefit that you learn much more. You learn not only how many distinct elements there are, but what they are too. So the first way that we're going to make progress in this question and be able to get by with much, much less space is by actually relaxing the question a bit, because instead all we want to do is we want to compute the number of distinct elements, but we don't actually want to store what they are. So one of the applications that people often talk about is you can think about some router having all of these IP addresses streaming by, and it wants to get some idea of how many distinct IP addresses it's seen. There's actually a kind of more fun one, which I thought I'd mention too, is sometimes actually in the opening lines of one of the famous streaming papers, and this, I should mention, the reason I underline streaming is because there are entire courses on this subject, trying to understand what you can do with just one or a few passes of the data, and with very small space that you can't actually store everything you're seeing. So MIT has an entire course on streaming that you can take. This is just a brief taste of some of these ideas to give you an idea for what else is out there. But you know, one of the standard questions that people ask is a kind of funny one, is how many distinct words did Shakespeare use? So you can imagine taking all of the collected works of Shakespeare and trying to stream through this and figure out, you know, how many distinct words he used. So of course, not this particular question, because this question we actually have an answer to. So does anyone have a ballpark guess for how many distinct words did Shakespeare use?
9,001.
10,000.
80,000.
You guys are really too married to O of 1 notation. Whoever said 9? You're going to be a great theorist.
1 million. O of 1.
O of 1, yeah. I heard some reasonable guesses in there. What were they?
10,000.
9,000.
So it's actually, 7, so I'll tell you, it was 31,534 distinct words. Any idea how many of them were used just once?
31,000. 14,000 something?
That is way too accurate for you not to know the answer. Can you put your microphone away? Do you want to tell me the other less significant digits too?
Oh, I closed the page.
All right.
Now I can't find it. Oh, yes, I found it.
Number
2 is 4343.
Well, this is what I got when I... we'll leave it at this. So this number were actually used just once. That's pretty amazing. So one of the opening quotes to a really famous paper, which is what we're going to be delving into in the first part of the lecture, and then we'll move on to some other topics too, is, I guess I'll put it over here. I don't need too much space for this. So this is a beautiful way to think about what these ideas mean. Exact answer like that. So for some questions, we really do know the exact answer. When you're talking about even bigger sets of data, maybe that's not a good idea. But just to put this in perspective, so the opening lines of this famous paper of Durand and Flageolet is that using only the memory equivalent to just 5 lines of printed text. You can actually compute the accuracy to within about 5%. The number of words that Shakespeare used. Actually, I'm sort of shortening this quote because a lot of times the way it's colloquially said is you're trying to answer the question, how many words did Shakespeare know? Which is actually a very different question and leads to other things. So the issue is he doesn't actually use all the words he knows. So there's actually another problem in computer science that's related to this issue of trying to estimate, from what you've actually observed, how many things are actually out there. So one of the famous names for that problem, which is a very different problem than the one we're talking about here, which is really just a very concrete and well-defined question with a particular answer. There's another version, which is trying to estimate how much he knew, and it's actually related to something called the German tank problem, which was, in World War II, based on looking at the different serial numbers for German tanks, you want to get some estimate of how many tanks they actually have. So a very famous problem. Maybe we'll talk about it some other time, but not today. So this is the first problem, it's just count the number of distinct elements in a sequence that's very, very large without actually storing what those distinct elements are. So any questions before we move on to actually what the approach will be that we're going to follow today? Question makes sense? All right. So let's do, and I guess I should attribute this quote. So let's do our first attempt at this before we give the full, gory approach. And here we're going to do what our favorite strategy is. Yep.
Before you start, are we going to get the exact number or are we going to get it within some epsilon accuracy?
That's a great question. We're going to get it within epsilon accuracy. Okay. Because for all of these types of problems, if you wanted the exact number, then you have no choice but to store it. So the way to think about this conceptually is what's going on is you can imagine somewhere at the end of the stream, right? You're trying to get by without storing everything that happened before. But if you took that last element, that last value that occurs, as you range it over the different answers, your algorithm would still have to get the right answer, which means it would have to know what the actual elements that were stored were. And you can actually make this formal and show that you really would need space that's linear in the number of distinct elements that have a hope of answering this question.
Does the algorithm know how many elements are in the stream?
That's another great question. So in a lot of, so sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. This one will actually be oblivious to this, but then again, I'm presenting a simplified version. A lot of times what you really assume is you're given an upper bound on the number of distinct elements, and that'll be something that parameterizes the space complexity of your algorithm. Yep. Did you have another question?
Rather than within epsilon of probability of the
correct
answer, alternatively,
can't we have a situation where we will be able to store a small amount of information by which, by certain properties of the end result, we can be sure that we have the right answer or know that what we have is possibly inaccurate?
Many ways of formulating that end up falling victim to the same type of lower bound. So I would have to think a little bit about what your particular way of getting around that is, but we can talk offline about it. Are there any more questions before we actually get into attempt number one? All right, let's do it. So any ideas what we should do? Let's use hash functions. That's all we've done so far, right? At some point, we're not going to cover hash functions. We're going to cover other algorithms. But for now, we're still going to use hash functions for this lecture. And I think beginning next lecture, we're really going to move on to some dimension reduction and very different types of techniques. But so the idea here is we're going to do is we're going to choose random hash function, which is going to map our universe into now the interval 0, 1. So this is a similar type of hash function that we talked about when we talked about consistent hashing, because we hashed both the jobs and the machines to figure out who owned which different jobs. But now the idea is what we're going to do is we're going to pass through the data, which is really just applying this hash function to each of the data elements in the stream sequentially. And what we're going to do is we're going to compute the min. That's it. That'll be our first attempt, is we just want the min value of the hash evaluated on all of the items in our stream. Yep.
This hash function is fully random?
We will assume it's fully random for this, for the, you know, there's actually a lot of work in trying to figure out how to not map it to the entire interval 0, 1, because you would instead care about some reduced bit complexity representation, but it'll be clearer when we get to that point why this should still work, even if it's not mapping it into the real interval within the range 0, 1. So for now, let's just focus on this idealized case and think about what's going on. Now, so the statement of what we're going to do makes sense, right? Why the min should be related to the thing that we want to compute is not at all obvious, but it will be. So, yep?
The min of the hashes?
Yes, exactly. So this is some value in 0,1, this is some value in 0,1. All the way through, all we do, instead of writing it out with pseudocode, I'll just tell you, all you do is you keep track of whatever the smallest value is of the hash evaluated on all of the items in your, all the values in your stream. So the first step before we get into this is going to understand how what we're computing, the min on the stream, which we just go through once and figure out what the min is, why this should at all be related to the types of things we want to estimate, which is the number of distinct elements. Does anyone have any intuition for this?
It's about 1 over the min.
Yeah. Let's see that. So let's do the following. So I'm going to let's see exactly where this intuition comes from, and that's great. Let's let y be this random variable, which is the min, over the entire stream. And what we're going to do is we're going to let capital N denote the answer to our question, the number of distinct elements. And we're going to relate these now. And the first cut relation will be very simple and exact. It's just that the expectation of y, first, what is the expectation over? Here? Just to make sure. H, exactly. This expectation is over h. So you think about the stream as being fixed, which fixes what the answer capital N is. Now the randomness here is over what the actual hash function is, but over that hash function, you get exactly a relation between the two, is that it's exactly equal to 1 over N plus 1. Not upper bounded by it, but exactly equal to it. So let me give you a few proofs of this. You know, the first proof is really, what would you do on a P set if you were stuck with a question like this, right? So you can do it less elegant ways, which is just you need to understand how you would actually be able to compute whatever the answer should be, which, you know, the expectation of y, you can just relate it to, you know, an integral. You would have your distribution over what the min is, and then, you know, you can figure out what that PDF is. There's a slightly more interesting way to do this, which is that you can rewrite what the expectation is as just being the integral over z of the probability that y is at least z. So this is another form for the expectation. The way to think about this is, you know, you should reason about this and make sure it makes sense to you in the case of a discrete probability distribution, that for each outcome in the space, the actual contribution on the right-hand side, if it were, you know, a sum instead, would contribute the right thing. Because actually, you know, whenever you start off with some outcome which is large in your space, it's going to contribute for all of the z's underneath it, and that's why it's actually computing the right thing. So there's just another form for the expectation, which is particularly convenient in some settings, which now we can just write this out, which, can anyone tell me what the probability y is at least z is, where y is the min? What should that be?
Z to the n?
Yeah, 1 minus z to the n. But yes, exactly. 1 minus z to the n, dz. And since we all remember calculus, we get this answer. And we get exactly the thing we were looking for, 1 over n plus 1. OK? Does anyone have any questions about that? Yep.
Why is the probability 1 minus z to the n?
Because, so if you think about the min, right? So that's, you know, you're given some value z, which is in the interval 0 to 1, and you're asking the chance that the min is at least as large as that. So if the value is z, you have all of this space 1 minus z, which is larger, and you want every single one of your values to be on that right-hand side. That's the only way the min is larger. As soon as you hit the other side, you're hosed.
Because the hash function is purely random.
Exactly. So you have to be a little bit more careful about, you know, once you start doing things like bounded independence. But, you know, actually there's a kind of clever way to think about this too, which a lot of times, you know, the other thing that you should try to do is to recognize different ways of thinking about probabilistic quantities you want to compute. So I claim there's also a clever way to think about this, which is the following. So, you know, alternatively, we can actually think about the expectation of y, which is this random variable of what is the min, as being, I'll explain this in a second, well, it's equivalent to the probability of choosing n plus 1 values in the interval 0 to 1, uniformly at random, and the last is the min. So why is that? You know, whatever y is, which is this random variable for the min over the first n guys, wherever that min lies, you know, let's say it's at z. Then if we take another sample from this uniform distribution on 0, 1, the chance that the next guy, the n plus first value, is actually smaller than the min is exactly whatever z is. So you can think about it alternatively as it's just the probability of choosing n plus 1 values, and that the last one is actually smaller than the others. And now, why are we done?
By symmetry, it's obviously.
Exactly. By symmetry. It's 1 over n plus 4. Okay? Yep.
Can you explain the last step about symmetry?
Yeah. So these, the probability that the last one is the min is the same as the probability that the second to last one is the min. It's the same as the probability that the third to last one is the min, all the way down. So the probability that one, then, you know, I can add up whatever that quantity is. I get n plus 1 times p is equal to the probability that one of them is the min. You know, they, as long as there are no ties, that's really what's going on, is you just divide through by n plus 1. So that's the way it works. That's the way you would make it formal, like that. All right, so now just as a quick sanity test, you know, just to make sure that we're on the same page. So now we have a statistic which its expectation is related to the thing that we care about. We want capital N without storing too much, without actually storing each of the distinct elements. But all we have is a relation between the expectation of Y and what we want to compute, N. So any ideas how we could go about, say, we want to show that Y is actually concentrated around the expectation, right? Because if the expectation is what it should be and gives us the right answer, if Y itself is incredibly unconcentrated, then actually observing the outcome of Y doesn't really tell us, you know, what the expectation is or how to actually invert and find our answer. So, you know, the main question here, at least at the end of part one, is how do we bound Y's deviation? So I'll give you some options, and you tell me what you think the answer is. I guess I'll add one more in light of the homework. Don't answer that. All right, so everyone on the same page? We want to bound Y's deviation because the expectation of Y gives us our answer, but if Y is nowhere near its expectation in a typical sample, that doesn't help us. So how can we try and bound Y's deviation? So can I see a show of hands? Markov? Chebyshev? Chernoff? Stochastic domination? All right. So anyone want to argue for Chernoff? Why Chernoff?
So I want to point out, you're being a little unfair because you haven't said exactly what, quote, Y's deviation means.
Uh-huh.
What notion of deviation you're going for here.
That's true, yeah. I mean, so let me tell you okay, so no one voted for Markov, no one voted for stochastic domination. So the issue with trying to apply Chernoff, if you actually pushed it through, that's a lot of times your natural reaction. It's just when I give you a list of things you want to use the souped-up one, right? Use the one that's a machine gun. The trouble is that Chernoff really relies on having a random variable that's the sum of independent random variables to get better and better concentration. So the issue is that at least the natural way of formulating this question really isn't a sum of independent random variables. So if you think about just as a, you know, thought experiment, right? If we took Y's value as we pass through the stream, it's something that's going down and down and down, but how much it decreases in the next step really depends on how much it's already decreased, because it doesn't have a lot of real estate to actually go down further, right? So that's why it's actually very difficult to try and model this as a sum of independent random variables. So even though your first reaction is always to use the souped up one, you want to make sure that it actually type checks with the way that you think about where it's useful for. So you should have your cheat sheet and think about Chernoff is useful when I have sums of independent random variables. But here the difficulty is that, at least in the natural way of phrasing this question, you don't. And we're going to use Chebyshev instead. So it makes sense? Any questions about this? So the main thing that we need to do to actually use Chebyshev now is we're going to have to bound the variance, right? So the variance of Y actually is at most 1 over n plus 1 squared. Now I'll just give you a sketch of this proof. So it's not as immediate or as elegant as the way that we analyze the expectation. In fact, that's not exactly equal to 1 over n plus 1 squared. But the way that you would do this is you can think about what the CDF is, right? So we already used the CDF in here because we knew answers like the probability Y is at least Z is exactly 1 minus Z to the n. But the way that you actually, you know, get a handle on the PDF in some cases, you can just if the CDF is easier to reason about, you can just differentiate the CDF to get you your PDF. And the end result is that the way that you can compute, let's say, the expectation of y squared, well, it's the integral over all of the different values that it could take of the value, which is z squared, times the value that the PDF assigns to it, which in this case is this quantity. So this comes as a normalization factor, just to make sure that this quantity really is the PDF. One thing you can do is you can check that if I were to plug in instead of z squared here, but z, I would actually get the same answer for the expectation of y as what I got, 1 over n plus 1. So you can check that. And I'm not going to do this integral in class, but you know, it's not hard to show that it really is 2 over n plus 1 times n plus 2. And then what you do at the end of the day, so this is really just designed as a sketch that you should check later just to make sure that you understand what's going on, is you would write it as the expectation of y squared minus the square of the expectation, which we know this guy right here is just 1 over n plus 1 squared, and this guy we know is 2 over n plus 1 times n plus 2. And if you work it out, you can check that it really is less than roughly 1 over n squared, and that's what you get your variance back. So I will leave filling in the details as a bit of an exercise, but does anyone have any questions about at least how you could go about computing the variance and just computing this integral and figuring it out this way? What is the plan of attack for how you would come up with the variance?
What are CDF and PDF?
Cumulative distribution function. Which, here the issue is that if I actually ask you for the random variable y, which is the min, what its distribution is over the interval 0, 1, actually in a lot of cases it's easier to think about what that is based on what the CDF of that random variable is. Because, for example, you already answered for me questions like, what's the probability that y is at least z? That was exactly 1 minus z to the n. So that gives you a form from the CDF. The PDF is a little tricky here because this is the PDF, and it has this funny n in here, out in front, but that's really just due to normalization factors. So the way that you would get that is you'd actually take the CDF and you would differentiate. So what you should do is you should convince yourself that if you wanted to do these things, for example, the computation of the expectation of y, less elegantly through something like symmetry, that this really is the PDF of that random variable, and then you just plug in z squared instead of z, because you're computing expectation of y squared, and that you really would get this out. So this is important in the analysis, but not really, you know, main focus for today. It's just that conceptually, if my game plan is to actually bound the deviation to show that y is concentrated around its expectation using the Chebyshev inequality, that's called the second moment method, so I better get a handle on what the second moment is of this random variable, and that's what it behaves like. So are there any other questions about this? Good? Okay, so now, so there's an issue, which is that the standard deviation here, if we think about the variance is 1 over n plus 1 squared, roughly, so the standard deviation is 1 over n plus 1. That seems kind of problematic now. So can anyone see any issues for directly applying this? Where would we get in trouble? Yep?
If you're trying to bound within one standard deviation, that includes 0 and whatever.
Exactly. Don't include 0. Exactly, right? So here we have this random variable whose expectation gives us the answer we care about. The trouble is that that answer for where the expectation is, we want y to be around that. Chebyshev isn't going to tell you anything better than you're concentrated within, you know, a constant number of standard deviations around the expectation. And on one side of that, we cross the zero. That's really, really bad because it means we're not distinguishing between, you know, n distinct elements and something like n squared distinct elements. So the first step in all of these things, you know, is not only is First, you figure out how a hash function, if it were random, computing some statistic of that hash function would get you some leverage on the answer you care about, some statistics of your data stream. Now, the next step is always, beyond attempt number one, how you can actually leverage multiple hash functions to do better. So all you're going to do is you're going to take independent draws from different hash functions and use that to create a better estimator that doesn't run into this issue that zero is within a standard deviation of the expectation. Does that make sense? All right, so let's do attempt number two. Attempt number two for dealing with this issue that we don't really know how to use Chebyshev here to get a strong enough guarantee. Well, the idea here is just to choose k hash functions. Same as before, these hash functions are going to map u, the universe, into 0, 1. But now the idea is, you know, each one of these gives us some statistic, y1, y2, up to yk, which is just the minimum for that particular hash, right? We fix one hash function like h1, and we pass through the stream, and we compute what the smallest value of the hash function h1 we see is over the stream. Now, the important thing is we do this k times. We don't do it with k passes over the data. We just do it with one pass over the data, keeping track of k things, and updating each one as we see a smaller value for each of them. Now, each one of these random variables is just an independent copy of y. So all we're going to do is we're going to set y now, y bar, to be equal to their average. That's the standard trick for using Chebyshev to boost the success of some estimator. It's just to take independent copies and add them up. Because the variance now of y bar, well, it goes down by a k factor each time. So the important point is that here what's going on is when we add up independent random variables, the yi's, the variances add, so we get an extra k factor. But because we've multiplied by 1 over k out front to normalize a property, we actually pick up an extra k squared that we save. So we're actually winning, and we're driving down the variance of our estimator. So now we can say by Chebyshev, we get exactly the probability that y bar deviates from its mean, which is still 1 over n plus 1, by more than epsilon over n plus 1. Well, we just plug that in. All we get is we plug in the variance of y bar here, and we plug in epsilon over n plus 1 quantity squared down here. That's just applying Chebyshev. Now, this variance we get here, and the n plus 1's cancel, and we end up getting the bound 1 over k epsilon squared. So if we want some epsilon, yeah, was there a question?
Is there a reason why we didn't use the turnoff bound while dealing with attempt number three?
Here we could use turnoff for this. That's not a big deal. But you could use it here because you actually do have sums of independent random variables. Let me keep it notationally simple and not actually, you know, have to use turnoff and just get first cut. But part of the reason why people often use Chebyshev for this is because they really want that the hash functions are pairwise independent, and that helps them use fewer of them, and that they're also too universal. So I'll just do it this way, even though you could. Yeah. But that's a great question.
Because turnoff implies that random variables are bounded also, and the result uses the bounds on them. I'm not sure if you actually get anything.
You get stronger concentration around it, but you wouldn't get concentration around more than the standard deviation anyways.
If you have a random variable could be as large as one,
uh-huh.
I think you might not get anything closer better until you have like basically on the order of n plus one samples.
Yeah, so in some range it'll get better, but I agree with you, it's not going to get too much better. In fact, it'll only get better after a really long time.
Yeah.
So that's yet another reason for not getting bogged down into it. But let's see the punchline before we get too lost here. Which is now what we know is that once that condition holds, that y bar is close to 1 over n plus 1. So we know that, you know, y bar is actually between 1 minus epsilon n plus 1 and 1 plus epsilon over n plus 1. And what this gives us then at the end of the day is that our estimate, 1 over y bar, I mean, you could do something like you could subtract off a 1 to make it actually an unbiased estimator, which would be great, but it's roughly, well, it's between n plus 1 over 1 plus epsilon and n plus 1 over 1 minus epsilon. So once you choose epsilon to be small, then you really do get some bounds that hold with this type of probability using Chebyshev that guarantee you that your estimate now, you know, you compute all of these y variables, y1 through yk, as you're going through in one pass over the stream, you figure out y bar, and you can just put an estimate like 1 over y bar minus 1, and that really will be close to the number of distinct elements in your stream. So that's, you know, one of the main punchlines here. So just as a... So the other aside that I want to mention, so are there any questions about this part of the analysis? We're going to move on to the second part of it, which will be, instead of estimating the number of distinct elements, estimating what are the most frequent items in a string, which is a very different kind of question. Yep.
So what are the conditions on your hash function? Like, obviously you can't, like, for this to be space efficient, you can't use, like, a completely random hash function.
I'm about to get to that.
Okay.
So as a quick aside, this would be really bad for space complexity, right? So as you know, as you just pointed out, the scheme right now has to keep track of what the min value is, and that's some real value in the interval 0 to 1. So in fact, it's extremely large space because it's unbounded, right? But the issue is that you don't actually need to keep track of what the min is, and you also don't need a hash function that really maps into the interval 0, 1. Instead, what you're going to do is, the real way that you're going to do this, is you're going to use a hash function that maps from your universe into bit strings, let's say, of length roughly log n. And you can even get away with a capital N here, that as long as you have some upper bound on the number of distinct elements you're going to see, you only need some logarithmic number of bits of resolution in order to actually get this to work. So that's actually the way you do it. It's a little bit, I mean, then you have to worry about a few more things. But if you think about it, I don't really care about super fine precision like something exponentially small for what the actual value of y is, because my estimate's not even that close to begin with to the right answer. So this is just a little bit of a lazier scheme that you only have to keep track of. Let's say the first log n leading bits of whatever that answer is. If I plug in 100 in here, that really means I'm discretizing the interval from 0 to 1 at some discretization of like 1 over n to the 100, which is perfectly fine for these types of things. So that's the aside for how you actually do it. So this is actually a sort of simplified explanation of one of the foundation papers in streaming, which is by Flageolet and Martin, which is actually predates this quote, and that's the algorithm that they were referring to, was this one. So what I want to do in the second part of today is to tell you how much further this type of streaming goes. So just to make sure that we're on the same page, you know, the naive strategy for counting the number of distinct elements would use space O of n, where n is the number of distinct elements. But here we're getting away with something that's exponentially smaller. It's actually logarithmic. And not only that, it does it in just one pass over the data. So this is the starting point of streaming, is how you can do much better in terms of space complexity.
With respect to the hash function itself, does like any universal hash function work? Like if the hash function is just like a totally random hash function, then like storing the function itself would be.
Yeah, so two universal, you can get that to work too. Mm-hmm. And then, so maybe something like that will be on the pset, but thanks for asking. Anyone have any other questions? All right, so let me tell you about the other part of today's lecture. So this is really just a crash course in streaming. What we're going to be talking about is we're going to be talking about heavy hitters and approximating frequent items. So the first thing that I want to do is I want to tell you about a standard version of how to compute frequent items. So this will not be the main focus, but this is just to make you aware of some of the competing approaches. And this always comes up on, you know, interview questions anyway. So it's maybe the reason the mystery Gries algorithm is famous is because of interview questions. Yeah, it's kind of interesting how the dynamics of these things work. But most of the time when you Google it, you're going to find people telling you how to ace Google interviews will be related to it. All right, so you know, now we're moving on to the second problem for today, which is really finding frequent items. Sometimes this is called heavy hitters, which is just a more colorful name for it. And what I'll be telling you about very briefly is what's called the Misra-Gries algorithm. This is from 1982. And we're going to do this quickly because the main focus today will actually be on understanding a different approach to this problem, which is called the count-min sketch. So we're going to have a similar type of problem that we're interested in. So here, you know, imagine you're given again a sequence, which is way too large to actually store. You're given the sequence x1, x2, and here I really am going to assume some bound on how long the sequence goes. That'll be little n. And your goal then is to output a list with the following properties. Well, this list, it's trying to contain one of the most frequent items. So what you want is you want at most k values in this list, for some parameter k that you're given. And what you want is you want that every value that really is a heavy hitter, so every value that appears at least n over k plus 1 plus 1 times, so strictly more than n over k plus 1, is on it. So you're given this huge stream of values, and you want to figure out at a high level which are the things that occur over and over again. So think about k as being maybe 100 or something. You want to output some summary of what are the 100 largest coins. Now, the catch is that not everything on the list really will have this property. You can't do that in a single pass over the stream. But what we will have the property is that everything that really is a heavy hitter, in the sense that it occurs at least n over k plus 1 times, will be on that list. So sometimes, actually, one of the funny names for this problem is the Britney Spears problem. Because you think about like query logs, and you want to figure out what are the heavy hitters, what are the things that occur over and over again. So that would be one of them, for sure. So it's a kind of funny name for this problem, but I haven't yet seen a paper that calls it that. Usually you call it the heavy hitters problem. What? You guys know who Britney Spears is, right? I really dated myself. You guys want me to call it the Justin Bieber problem?
LIGO.
What?
LIGO problem.
If
can you guys help me out here?
There's a huge announcement about a physics experiment called LIGO a few days ago.
Oh, okay, yeah,
an email
yeah.
From the MIT.
Yeah, this is the gravitational waves.
Yes.
All right.
It crashed their server.
Yes. All right.
Actually, quite appropriate.
So I got booed for saying Justin Bieber. That's good. That was test number one.
We all passed.
So, let Let me tell you about Mr. Gree's algorithm. And then we're going to move on to what's called Kempnian sketch. If we don't finish it, we'll continue it next time. So the idea for Mr. Gree's, actually many of you may have seen a special case of this, just with k equals 1, where you're trying to find all of the items that occur a majority of the times with just a single pass. But all you do for Mr. Gree's is you initialize an empty list to begin with. And then all you do is, for each item, well, if it's the same as some item or value, whatever you want to call it, on the list, what you're going to do is you're going to increment its counter. So you're storing a list which will only have at most k items on it. Each of those items are the candidates for what the heavy hitters are. Every time you see an item that is already on your list of candidates, you're going to increment the counter to try and, you know, keep it around for longer. So otherwise, if it's not on the list, and there are less than k items on the list, so think about this as just what he initialized the list to begin with, that's completely empty. What are you going to do is you're going to add it to the list and increment its counter. And what you're going to do in the remaining case, where the list already has k items, and the item that you just found doesn't occur in the entire list at all, is what you're going to do is you're going to throw that item away, but what you're going to do is you're going to decrement all the other counters of the items on this list. There are k of them. And what you're going to do is you're going to delete items whose counter reaches zero. Okay? So very simple thing. At the end of the day, what you're going to output for your heavy hitters are just whoever is in your list that's left over. So the idea for this is actually, it's very intuitive. So the first thing I want to mention is, if we think about the space complexity of this algorithm, what I claim is that it uses k log n bits of space, for obvious reasons, because all it's keeping track of are k items and counters, which go up to at most log n. But the correctness for this is really just that if we let fx denote the frequency of item x, you know, how often it actually occurs in the stream, then the key lemma, which tells you that this actually works, is at the end, x's counter is at least fx minus n over k plus 1. Okay? And that guarantees that this algorithm really does work for solving this version of the heavy hitters problem, because if you had an item that actually occurred at least n over k plus 1, plus 1 times, then this lemma tells you that its counter has to be at least 1, which means it actually is on the list.
This is counting things not on the list is having counted as 0.
Yes, exactly. Things that do not occur on the list, counting as 0. So does the lemma make sense, and does the algorithm statement make sense? So any questions about this? Yep?
And the last line, is that inequality or inequality between fx and n over k plus 1?
So this is just inequality, so at least.
Okay, this is a subtraction sign, got it.
Yes. This thing is a subtraction sign, this is an inequality, its counter is at least whatever its frequency is, minus n over k plus 1. Good? Anyone have any intuition for this? I mean, I didn't leave myself much space for the proof, so it really is that short, unless I'm planning on rolling up the board and continuing it.
Every time you see an item that's not on the list, you decrease all the counters.
Yep.
So that means that,
So let me add some nomenclature. It's actually funny to see it the first time. You can be surprised by it the first time, but the analysis really is this short. The idea is that if we fix X and we look at each elimination of X, here what I mean by an elimination of X is, for example, X could be one of the items on the list, but something causes its counter to be decremented. That's like having one copy of X at that list that all of a sudden gets tossed away. The other way that we can think about eliminating a copy of X is, what if X comes along and the entire list is full with things not X? Then we throw away that X, but in so doing, we throw away one item from each of the other lists. Those two things we can think about as eliminating some X, either because some item came along and caused us to decrement its counter, or because it wasn't counted to begin with, and we threw it away to decrement other guys' counters. Yeah.
So then every time you throw away an X, the total decrement is K plus one, right?
Yes, exactly. Perfect. So this implies that the key thing in all of this is just having the right notion of what it means to eliminate, which is, you know, one of those two cases. You're thinking about the counter is really, you know, storing a set of copies. Every time you decrement it, you're throwing away an X. Or sometimes you're literally throwing away an X because you're decrementing other counters. The important thing is that each time you do that, it eliminates a other items, no matter what you do.
K other.
So,
by eliminate, it should be K plus one. Decrements a counter.
Yes, exactly. So then, the issue is that, because you're pairing it up in tuples of K plus one, each X gets paired with a tuple of K other values that are different from it, you're really in tuples of K plus one. And what this means then is that no more than n over k plus 1 occurrences of x can be eliminated. Period. Because whenever you're removing something, you're removing them in tuples of k plus 1. So a lot of times you'll see this also stated just in the special case of k equals 1. In this case, what you're really looking for is you're looking for items that are majority items. So they occur strictly more than half of the time. And there you would only keep track of one counter. So the point is that every time you're throwing away an X, you're throwing away some other item that's not X. So if X really is a majority element, it has to survive until the end. And there's no choice. This is just a natural generalization of this standard interview question to K items. Yep.
So the item that's being, that was not on the list and is causing decremented is the plus one in the k plus one?
Yes, exactly. Because then it's really a tuple of, you know, there are k other things, and there's one occurrence of x, it's a tuple of k plus one. But just double check that you understand where exactly the k and the k plus one comes from. So this is, you know, one of the standard things that you can do for finding frequent items. There's actually a very different approach to this problem, which is quite interesting. It's interesting in streaming how there are wildly different approaches. We're going to actually build on that next time we start talking about things like dimensionality reduction, which uses some similar ideas to how you could sketch properties about sequences. But what I want to do in the remainder is I want to tell you about a completely different approach to this question of trying to find frequent items. So it's called the count min sketch. So let me first introduce you to it, and then its properties will be building on exactly the things we've done so far. will be the main second part. I'll call this problem number two. We want epsilon approximate frequency counts. So it sounds like a similar problem. It's slightly different in what we actually ask of it, which is, again, we're given a sequence that's too large to store in memory. And I'll assume an upper bound xn. And the goal is we want to be able to answer queries like count of x, which in a perfect world would be exactly how many times some value x occurs in this different stream. So you think about passing through this entire stream, and you want some summarization of how often different values occurred in the stream. So in a perfect world, this would be exactly f of x, which is the frequency of item x. But here, what we're really going to do is we're going to ask that it be at most epsilon n. So we want something comparable to the number of things in the output to begin with. You can think about this as if you plug in something like epsilon as 1 over 2k, then it's actually solving a very related problem, which is if you can answer queries within some additive n over 2k, then what you're really able to answer are questions like, is this item a heavy hitter? Does it occur about n over k times? Everything that occurs at least n over k times is something that whatever your estimate is going to be will be at least n over 2k, and everything that occurs very rarely, so less than n over 3k, then this type of guarantee would ensure that you don't overestimate it by too much. So it's a very comparable type of problem, but slightly different, because you actually want to be able to answer all sorts of queries about the different frequencies. And the idea for count min sketch, it's a beautiful idea. Equally simple to analyze. This is due to core mode and Muthu Krishna. You know, the funny thing about teaching some of these things is that for you guys, these are just names, but you know, whenever I write that name, I'm thinking about the actual guy whose hair changes color every time I see him. So he's an interesting fellow. But you can Google him later. Yep.
So is the idea that you get to sweep through the sequence once every time they query for a new x, or what?
No, definitely not. Call it a day.
Right.
And we could just count it.
So you want to be able to compute this for all x?
Exactly. Because the way to think about it is, no one's telling you you can even store your stream, or that it is being stored at the beginning.
But this
it
would mean that you would have enough space to store, like, all of the distinct elements.
Mm-hmm. No. I'm not going to store that many. That's why it's cool.
Okay.
It sort of depends. You're going to see there's going to be space dependence on epsilon.
Yes. So as epsilon gets smaller and smaller, I can't plug in an arbitrary epsilon, because then, you know, I really would have to store it for very similar reasons to what we talked about. But there are going to be two parameters. I wouldn't worry too much about these, but just think first, at your first glance, what they represent. So one of the parameters is L, which is going to represent independent trials. So this is the same way that when we talked about distinct elements, we're able to boost the success probability by repeating. Because we had this issue that when we computed the variance, we didn't actually get something that was good enough to use Chebyshev, because lo and behold, the expectation, the thing we wanted to compute, was within a standard deviation of zero, which was bad. And we're also going to have a parameter, B, which is the number of buckets. So this is what your output is when you're actually applying a hash function. And the idea is that we're just going to create some table of values. That's L by B. which is nothing more than an array that's every time we see an item, we're going to update this array. So we initialize it to all zero, and I'm going to use CMS, the denote count min sketch, which is really just this array, which is L by B. And don't worry about L, it'll be a similar parameter to the way that we boosted using distinct elements by taking multiple hash functions. Now let me tell you what the actual algorithm does. Very simple. So all you're going to do is you're going to choose L, random hash functions, H1. So that's our replication. And now they go from this universe to B, because that's the number of buckets. So this hash function chooses which column we apply it to. And all we're going to do is for each of the values, you know, as we go through the stream, well, what we're going to do is for each of the hash functions, we're going to increment. We're going to choose the row j, which is which hash function we're using, and then we're going to increment wherever that item lands, whichever bucket. So we choose which hash function, that's 1 through L that chooses the row, and once we choose this hash function, then that tells us which column a particular value x falls into, and we just increment that counting. So this is very simple. You couldn't ask for a simpler sketch. Now the question is, you know, how can we use this array of values at the end of the day to actually try and approximate the things we care about, namely the frequency of different values of x? So, you know, how do we use this count min sketch data structure to approximate fx? So there's a key claim in here. So the same way that we talked about distinct elements, there's the issue of, you know, how the statistics we're computing relate to the statistics we care about to begin with. Let's do the same thing. Let's figure out how CMS at least stores some interesting values and get a handle on how they relate to the things we care about, fx's, and what the source of the randomness is, why they deviate from those values. So the key claim in all of this is the following. This is what it's all built on, is that if you fix any x and j. So you fix some value x whose frequency you care about. Then the claim is, and you even fix which hash function, so this will be true for all the different hash functions, that if you look in that hash function's row and you look at the hash, you know, you look at choosing that column based on the hash function, the claim is that it's actually an upper bound for the frequency fx. So does anyone see why this is true? Yep.
I mean, you're just incrementing every time it hashes correctly to that bucket, and then other things might hash to the same.
Perfect. Exactly. Right? That's exactly right. Is that just to write out exactly what you said, each time we see x, we certainly increment CMS of j, of hj of x. But moreover, it's an overestimate because sometimes we increment it for other reasons. We can also increment it, you answered my other question too, which is we can also increment for other reasons. And the main reason here is collisions. So we see the same thing appearing again. The first time we saw collisions was because we cared about access time for hash functions. In this case, it really represents how often someone else is playing X's role for a particular hash function. So the idea is if we have this type of inequality, does anyone have an idea how we can use countmin sketch to actually estimate f of x? Like, what should we output as our estimate?
I guess we need to output the min over the different hash functions.
Exactly. After all, I haven't used the word min yet. Right? It goes through in some sequence of different tables that it occurs in. Can all see this one? All right. And wherever it occurs in, whatever those values are always upper bounds on f of x. So if we choose the minimum, it's guaranteed to be the one that's actually closest to it. Now, the entire thing is to try and understand why it's not too much larger, is to understand what this random variable is about, what its deviation is from f of x, and then the bound effect. So this is pretty straightforward. So the analysis here is that if we look at what count min sketch actually evaluates to. So let's let zj, so we'll fix one of the hash functions. We'll define it to be CMS of j of hj of x. Now zj, we can write it out. It is f of x plus the sum of the frequencies of all the y's where y collides, according to this hash function, with x. Right?
Well, if you want this y, like, not equal to x, or...
Y not equal to x. Good point. Thanks. Y not equal to x. Thanks. So all the other y's, which happen to collide. Right? And so now, well, we can compute, for example, the expectation of zj. Well, by the fact that it's two universal, you know, that we've chosen it, or even if it were random, this would certainly be true, that it would be the sum over all y, fy, divided by b, because the collision probability is 1 over b for these different guys. So this quantity right here, can anyone tell me what that is? Yeah, exactly. So we'll upper bound it. We'll even be a little bit sloppy. It would really be, you know, n minus fx over b. That would be the exact form, and then I'm just going to upper bound it this way. So now we know roughly how we should set b here. We want something which has about epsilon times n accuracy. So we're going to set b to be about, you know, 2 over epsilon, 10 over epsilon, something like that. And that'll be enough to say that the expectation is roughly where it should be. Now, one of the problems that people have sometimes with countmin sketch is that the estimates that it outputs are actually biased. They're not unbiased estimators because they're always above what the true expectation is. There are lots of things people do to try and get similar properties, but things which are unbiased. Let's work through with just this anyways. So now we're almost done with the analysis. Right on time. So to continue the analysis here, so we're going to do, as I mentioned, is we're going to set, let's say, b to be 2 over epsilon. This is not really so important. Then the important thing is that now, by Markov, we have that the probability that zj minus fx is at least epsilon n is at most a half. So the entire punchline right here is that the reason we can apply Markov, remember, Markov only applies when it's a non-negative random variable. But we really do have a non-negative random variable here, which is zj minus fx. So the expectation of this non-negative random variable is epsilon n over 2, by the way I've chosen b. So the chance that it's double that, you know, compared to its expectation, is at most a half. Yep?
Why doesn't our choice of b depend on l?
Why doesn't it depend on l? Yeah. Oh, so here, I mean, you could, but I'm going to use l in a different way. So let's just use this choice for b to keep things simple. And,
so I guess it's like pessimistically...
Well, right, so b here, I mean, here what we're doing is we're then going to appeal to independence across the different, you know, l's. So l really is the boosting, you know, how much we want the failure probability to be and how much we can tolerate it. That governs how we choose l. But really, this is an analysis for a single hash function, which then should only depend on things like at what granularity you want to approximate the actual frequencies. That tells you roughly things, how many things you should collide into, you know, in order for it to work out. Is there questions? All right. So let's finish up with the analysis now, which is that the last step in here is that by independence, we have the probability of the min over j from 1 to l of zj is actually too large for our taste. You know, it's at least fx plus epsilon n. You know, it can't be on the other side of fx. While this is, at most, 1 over 2 to the l. So what we can do, just to put this back on the same, you know, ground as things like Mr. Agrees, so that we can compare the things, you know, one thing we can do is we could set, for example, epsilon to be like 1 over 2k or something else like this, because it's then at least in the same ballpark that the things it's trying to get the frequency right, the things where being within an additive epsilon n is really constraining and doesn't allow you to just output zero, are things which are heavy. So they're things that occur quite frequently, where they have, you know, the fraction times they occur is about on the order of 1 over k. So in that setting, the total space usage for this entire thing, you know, if we were to set, for example, L to be something like O of log n, so that each of the different items that we query it, we're getting the right answer with high probability, then the overall space usage that we're using here is just well, we have this k by l different grid, and each one of them has to store a counter. So we end up with you know, roughly this answer, we have b times l. So we get something that's pretty comparable, but it's actually going to able to guarantee us that when we query things now, that the reason they had a large frequency value, something that was much larger than, you know, n over 2k, is not an accident, and it really is because it's something that was a heavy hitter. So this is a completely different approach, but it achieves roughly comparable guarantees. So this is Count Min's sketch. So I wanted to emphasize that, you know, one of, you know, just as a quick takeaway here, we talked in the beginning about hash functions as just built up a lot of probabilistic tools. We talked about things like consistent hashing are very clever ways to teach an old dog new tricks, how to do things like defray the load in modern applications where the number of servers is changing, and to do things like routing when you have inconsistent views. So this is one theme of how you can actually use hash functions to get some very interesting algorithms. They're one of the basic building blocks in algorithm design to get things like, you know, very low space usage. We're going to use them in the next lecture, or ideas related to hashing and randomness, to do things like dimension reduction. How we're faced with very high dimensional data, we can actually treat it as if it were much lower dimensional. And throughout the course, we're going to see this kind of theme again and again, that we're going to build up some basic tools, and then we're going to figure out how to use them in many different algorithmic settings. Okay? So good luck on your homework. Yep.
Where does the log squared come from?
So this is because I have a b by l thing.
Right, and b times l gives you k log n.
Yes, but I also have to store a counter in each one.
Oh.
Under min, what's your bounds?